In another video, I showed you how you could deploy a basic web application on EC2 and have that web application store data in a relational database, in a MySQL database in that video, with help of the Amazon RDS service, the relational database service offered by AWS. In this video here, I have the same basic website and web application, but this time it'll not store data in a relational database, in a MySQL database with RDS, but instead in a NoSQL key value database. To be precise, the data will be stored in DynamoDB, another AWS database service. Now, the key difference is that with DynamoDB, we're having a NoSQL approach, which means whilst we can have multiple tables and related data, relations are not baked into the database system or the database engine as they are with relational database systems like MySQL. We also don't use the SQL language for querying, and we have a more flexible database schema. In a given table, not all data must have the same shape. It can have the same shape. Different records and different rows can have the same shape, but they don't have to. Now, DynamoDB is a database service and engine created by AWS, by Amazon therefore, and unlike MySQL or PostgreSQL or other relational database engines, you can't easily install DynamoDB on your own server. Whilst you could install MySQL on an EC2 instance and manage that database server totally on your own, DynamoDB is intended to be used through the DynamoDB service. So service and database engine are basically the same thing there. With RDS, they were not the same thing. With RDS, the RDS service is just a service that makes it easier to run relational database servers powered by MySQL, PostgreSQL, or other relational database engines. With DynamoDB, there is no differentiation. Instead, the service is basically the database. Now, as with all these other videos you might have watched, this video is not there to get you started with AWS or give you a thorough overview of all the AWS services. Instead, I have a dedicated course for that in case you're interested, a course that gets you started with AWS and even helps you pass your first entry-level certification in case you're interested. Now, if you take a look at the code that's responsible for interacting with the database, and of course you do find that code attached if you're interested, then you'll notice that unlike the code that used the relational database approach, we have no SQL statements anymore. Instead, we're using the AWS SDK and various functions or objects or constructor functions, to be precise, exported by these libraries to then send commands to DynamoDB. For example, a command to put data into a DynamoDB table. And here you can already see that there is basically no difference between the service and the actual database. Instead, as mentioned, the service is the database. That's why we're using the AWS SDK. With the MySQL database powered by RDS, we did not use the AWS SDK. Instead, I used another third-party package for sending SQL commands to the database server. That was possible because, as mentioned before, the RDS service is just a service that's used to spin up a managed relational database engine server, a managed MySQL server, for example. With DynamoDB, we're not using the DynamoDB service to spin up a DynamoDB database. Instead, the DynamoDB service is the database, and we're then just sending AWS SDK commands to that service to, for example, store data in the database or to query and retrieve data from the database. That's what these different SDK commands do. And of course, you learn more about the available commands and the configuration they expect in the AWS SDK documentation. That's how you learn how to use the different AWS SDK packages. So that's the code, and that's the general difference between RDS and relational databases on the one side and DynamoDB on the other side. In this concrete example here, I'm targeting two tables, one table named Topics and one table named Opinions, where my data is stored. We could also restructure the code and the data to store everything in one table because, as mentioned, relations are not really a thing in DynamoDB. And indeed here I have no join commands as I did with MySQL, instead I manually query and connect all the data I need. If you're interested in learning more about that, feel free to go through that code in greater detail. Now, in order to use this code, we of course need to spin up another EC2 instance that runs the web server, but we'll also need to create those database tables in advance. And that's another difference. In my SQL code, I did actually create the tables here when the web server was started for the first time. I did that because, again, with RDS, we just create the database servers. We don't have direct access to the database through RDS. There are ways of sending queries to the database through RDS, but we don't have direct access to the database tables and so on. Instead, we just spin up and configure that managed server. With DynamoDB, that's different, and that's why we have to visit the DynamoDB service page first, and then there we can create our database tables. And that's also interesting. We don't create a database as a first step. Instead, there are no different databases. Instead, we directly create tables and AWS manages them in databases and on database servers behind the scenes for us. Because DynamoDB is basically also a serverless database service. We don't have to configure any hardware or anything like that. Instead, we just create tables and AWS takes care about efficiently storing the data thereafter. Now, what does matter is the region. We can have different tables in different regions, and of course it matters which region we choose. It matters because, for example, in the code, I have to define in which region my DynamoDB tables will be. So all these commands will then automatically be looking for these tables in this region. And therefore, here I'm picking this US East 1 region, and there I'll create my first table. And that's my topics table. Topics because that's the name I also pick here in my commands. You could pick a different table name, but you would need to adjust the code then. Now, after picking a table name, when creating a DynamoDB table, you have to choose a partition key as the next step. The partition key is basically the main key, the primary key, you could say, of a given entry in that database table. So every entry you add to that database table must have a value for that partition key, which you choose here. Now in my case, I plan to have an ID field as my primary key, but you could use any field that's guaranteed to be unique for your different entries. And here I will therefore choose ID as a name for my key. The value will be string because my IDs won't be numbers but instead strings because I'm using a package here that generates those string IDs. Now we could add a second key and then together these keys would form a so-called composite key, but we'll not do that for this table, instead we'll do it for another table later for the second table we need to be precise. Hence here we only have that partition key. Now, there is way more you could say about these partition keys and about DynamoDB in general. You could create an entire course on DynamoDB, but that's not the focus of this video. Instead, here I just want to get you started, and therefore these are the essentials you should know. Now, as a next step, we can either take these default settings or customize them, and I'll do the latter so that I can walk you through the remaining settings. Now it starts with the table class, DynamoDB Standard or DynamoDB Standard Infrequent Access. And here it really depends on our data access patterns. If we're storing data, which we're not accessing too often, then this infrequent access storage option here might be a good choice because that offers some cost savings then. On the other hand, if we do access our data frequently, we should use the standard option here, because it would then actually be more expensive if we choose the infrequent access option, if we're then accessing the data frequently. So therefore here, I'll stay to the default. And next we have this capacity calculator. Now capacity is a special thing about DynamoDB. It basically defines what we have to pay for the DynamoDB table we're creating here. Because when we create that table, we can choose how much read and write capacity we want to provision. So how much read and write access we expect to hit that table. That's in the end what we're setting here. And you can calculate the capacity you should choose down there with that capacity calculator. For example, if you expect that a single database entry, a single row, you could say, has a size of 1 kilobyte, and you could simply create an example entry and store that in a file and check how big that file is to get a rough estimate, then you can estimate how often you're going to read and write items of that size to a table. And then some advanced options that basically just say if a read is guaranteed to have all the latest writes taken into account, or if there could be some overlapping. And you would then see what the read and write capacity units are that you should choose down there. Now you can then make those choices with the autoscaling turned on or off. And autoscaling simply takes care that if you exceed your estimates, you automatically provision more capacity so that reads or writes are not blocked, but instead are still successful. If you know that you're not going to exceed your estimates, you can of course turn autoscaling off. And that's what I'll do for this demo, and I'll choose just one capacity unit for both read and write, because here for this demo, I won't read and write a lot. It's also worth mentioning that as part of the free tier, you do get 25 provisioned write or read capacity units per month. So you want to stay below these limits across all tables to make sure that you're not paying for your demos. So therefore, these are the choices I pick here. An alternative would be on-demand, where you simply pay for the actual reads and writes you have. And that can, of course, be a great option if you can't estimate how many reads or writes you'll have, or if you have a very spiky demand where you don't have any reads or writes for long periods of time, but then suddenly you have a lot of reads or writes. So on-demand could then be a great option. Here, I'll stay to this simple provisioning approach. Now next, we could create secondary indexes, and an index simply is a setting that can help you improve the performance of the queries you're going to run against the table. And indexes make sense if you plan to run queries that filter based on some field that's not one of your keys, your partition or your sort key. If you have data stored in your database table and you know that you're going to query that data where you then want to filter based on some field that's not one of these two keys, then your queries by default would not be super fast, and you can speed them up by turning that field on which you're planning to filter into an index. That's what you can do here. We don't need any index for this demo, and therefore we can stick to these defaults. We can stick to the default encryption settings here to keep that simple, and then create that table. Now that's the first table. I will also create a second table, and that's my opinions table, because that's the other table I'm targeting in my code. Therefore we'll do that next. And here my partition key is topic ID. Now the topic ID is actually the ID of a topic stored in another table. So I'm basically creating my own relations here without official support for it, but I can of course store any data I want and then later use that data in my code to manually connect data, which is what I do in that code down here. But since I can have multiple opinions on the same topic, I might have repeated topic IDs in that table. Now, the partition key should be storing unique values if it's the only key. But you can also add a sort key in addition, and then the two keys together have to be unique. So the values for the two keys together have to form a unique value for every entry in the database table. And therefore here, I'll actually use the creation date as a sort key, and this will also be a string. And therefore now every opinion will have a topic ID, which is not unique, but a unique date. And therefore together we'll have that unique set of combinations. Now, besides that, I'll choose the same settings as before, provision capacity without auto scaling, and choose the lowest capacity possible here. No indexes needed. And therefore now we have these two tables created. With those tables created, that's everything we have to do regarding the DynamoDB database. Because again, we don't have to choose any hardware or spin up any server. Instead, that's all taken care of by AWS under the hood, because DynamoDB is a managed serverless service in the end. I just briefly want to mention that you can, of course, also tweak the settings of a table after you created it. And you could, for example, turn on global tables to have AWS automatically replicate the data in a table across multiple regions so that, for one, you don't lose that data or temporary access to the data if something's wrong with that region where you created the table, but also so that you can deliver that data faster to different applications and users that might be running in different regions of the world. Now, this will cost you extra, but it is a feature you could enable. You can also manage your backups here and choose how data should be backed up, and you can also restore backups here, but we don't need any of that. And with that, we did now get started with DynamoDB, and I did create these tables which are needed in order to connect this web application, this web server which we're about to run, to that database. Now, running that web server is something I'll do in another video, which is of course linked to this video. So you find a link to that other video on this video here. In that other video, we're going to run this web server on an EC2 instance and make sure that this web server also has the appropriate permissions it needs to access these DynamoDB tables.